Nice, thank you, Becky. Thank you, Becky. Okay. So welcome to Gloria Day Lutheran Church here in Coos Bay, Oregon. We're glad to have you with us. And with me this morning, of course, is Becky Bell Greenstreet on piano. Mo and Dave are back, so yay for that. Their tests were negative, and they have rejoined us this morning. Doris Smith and Callie Mill are also with us, and Angela McAllister is ever on our tech person this morning. My name is Pastor Peggy Yeast, and it's a pleasure to be worshiping with you this morning. One little note, I wanted to mention that although it doesn't look like it this morning, spring is on its way. Vern and Judy were here all day yesterday planting flowers. 2 weeks ago, they had weeded the section where the roses are by the front door, so it's beautiful. So next time you're by, make sure you take a special note and look at that. Diane Rippey has been also doing other things around the property, so take note, spring is on its way. So with that, we will have our call to worship. Thank you. We will have a remembrance and our litany next week, which was the first time last year, the anniversary of us meeting in the diaspora, away from here. So, blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock, and our Redeemer.
Amen. Amen.
God hears us when we cry and draws us close in Jesus Christ. Let us return to the one who is full of compassion. Fountain of living water, pour out your mercy over us.
Our sin is heavy, and we long to be free. Rebuild what we have ruined, and mend what we have torn. Wash us in your cleansing blood. Make us alive in the Spirit to follow in the way of Jesus. As healers and restorers of the world, you so love. Amen.
Beloved, God's word never fails. The promise rests on grace. By the saving love of Jesus Christ, the wisdom and power of God, your sins are forgiven, and God remembers them no more. Journey in the way of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
So I think.
our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thanks be to God.
Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good.
For God's mercy endures forever.
Let the redeemed of the Lord proclaim.
Let God redeem them from the hands of the foe.
Gather them in from the land.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God.
That he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and the people refuse to trust rather than trust, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true to the light come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
And you may have noted that I use the word trust and refuse to trust in place of light and dark. That's really what the Greek is getting at. It's easier for us to see light and dark. So just giving us a different perspective. One of the confirmation traditions at the church where I grew up was that each confirmand received a special Bible verse selected especially for them by the pastor. Mine was from Philippians 4, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Then, nearly 25 years ago, when I started teaching confirmation after one of our pastors had retired, and way before I had any thoughts of seminary, I wanted to continue the tradition, but with a twist. I'd give the young people a list of about 20 suggested verses and let them pick one that most resonated with him or her. And I've continued that tradition throughout my ministry. I'll offer the same list to Bren and Haley Buskerud before their affirmation of baptism service in May. John 3:16, which is part of today's gospel reading, is on that list, of course. Heck, isn't it everyone's favorite Bible verse, or at least the one you can memorize or remember the easiest? "For God so loved the world that God gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life." But instead of merely glancing at this one verse that we all know so well, this one verse that Martin Luther called the gospel in a nutshell, this one verse that sums up the entire New Testament, let's look at it a little closer. In Jesus' statement to his disciples, I think he expresses that God is fundamentally a God of love. That love is the logic by which the kingdom of God runs, and that God's love trumps everything else in the end, even justice. But not everyone reads it this way. After all, Jesus says everyone who believes will receive eternal life. And that, to me, implies a those who don't believe. When we truly think about how some might read this verse, it doesn't sound like the unconditional love I believe that God shows us. It seems to me, in the way that this verse was written, that it's a suggestion that we have to do something before we're able to be saved. Or that works. Jeez, somebody's calling me. It's Joy. Let's see. You know, if we have to do something to make ourselves savable, doesn't that seem like works? I mean, and that seems so un-Lutheran to me. That before salvation can happen, we need to fulfill a list of prerequisites to satisfy God before we are even worthy of God's overflowing grace. You might come to see salvation as a transactional experience rather than a relationship sustained by God's love for us. I do something and then you do something. Transactional experience. So way back in the mid-90s, one of my confirmands was Patrick, our pastor's son. When it came time for his confirmation, he told me he didn't like any of the texts that were on my list. Instead, he asked if he could use a verse that he found on his own. I mean, really, what pastor would say no to that? He asked if his verse could be John 3:17, which I thought was an odd choice. Why not just go with a popular John 3:16? But when you reread verse 17, I think you'll understand why he picked it. Jesus expands on his earlier verse and says, "Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Period. This verse actually feels much more godlike to me. It certainly did to Patrick. It feels much more unconventional and loving. Unconditional loving to me. Did you hear that? There is no requirement for our salvation. And unlike the verse that precedes it, there is no implied judgment for those who don't believe. Just that through Jesus, everything and everyone will be saved through him. Even so, what we might think of as the judgment to come for those who don't believe is not punishment or damnation to hell. Anyway, I think it's a loss. It is, but it's a loss. I don't think it is, but it's a loss. It's a tragic loss in that the non-believer doesn't recognize during his or her life that God loves them and that God saves the world by becoming vulnerable and sacrificing God's self for us, for them, for us. God comes in love to redeem loss, to turn tragedy into victory over death. After we've given it some thought, however, like Patrick, we might not pick this scripture verse as our favorite either, because we realize that it's quite contrary to our world and quite often contrary to our lives as well. Most of the world operates according to the more traditional belief that security comes not through vulnerability and sacrifice, but through power and might. We live in a world that seeks security not only through power, but also through wealth and consumption. And we are taught from a very early age to avoid true vulnerability and the truly vulnerable at all costs. So, sacrifice? Sure, when we can afford to. Love our enemies? Maybe, if everything else is taken care of first. Vulnerability? Well, only when I have no other choice. The kind of self-sacrificing love Jesus offers is frightening. to such a world. No wonder some run and hide from it. Some leave the church because staying requires us to trust nothing other than God. And we so want to trust in ourselves. Most of us find it impossible to embrace Jesus' example except when we ourselves have been brought so low by illness or loss or a broken relationship or dashed hopes in some other way. The problem with the worldview is that no matter how hard we try, no matter what position we may achieve, no matter how much money we may make and save, we cannot secure our salvation ourselves or save our own lives. Only God can do that. Only love can do that. And it's frightening to be so utterly dependent on God. But there's a second reason why John 3:16 may not be our favorite verse. And that's because of the claim it makes on us. Notice that God doesn't ask our permission first before sending Jesus to die for us. I know, this may seem like an odd detail to point out, but think of the claim a person or any person has on us once they've saved our life, let alone died doing it. In the face of such love, such sacrifice, we must surrender all our claims of saving ourselves. David Lowe, biblical scholar and a former president of the Lutheran Seminary in Philadelphia, tells of the time he preached a sermon about the offensive nature of God's grace, suggesting that we might add four words to the end of our service of baptism, saying, "Child of God, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, like it or not." He said that a few weeks later, a friend shared a bedtime encounter he'd had with his own son. Upset that his father was putting him to bed earlier than he had wanted to go, 6-year-old Benjamin said, "Daddy, I hate you." Benjamin's father, exercising great parental restraint, replied, "Ben, I'm sorry you feel that way, but I love you." Benjamin's response to such kind words surprised his dad. "Daddy, don't say that." "I'm sorry, Benjamin, but it's true. I love you." "Don't," his son protested. "Don't say that again." At which point, Ben's father, remembering the words of his pastor's sermon, said, "Benjamin, I love you, like it or not." Why was Benjamin protesting his father's love? Perhaps because he realized he could not control his father's love and twist it to his advantage. In the face of such love, there is no beginning and ultimately no control whatsoever. If his dad had said that if he ate all his vegetables, he could stay up late, or agreed that Ben could stay up later this night if he went to bed earlier tomorrow, then Benjamin would have been a player. He would have exercised some measure of control over the situation and indeed over his dad. But in the face of unconditional love, Benjamin was powerless, and so are we. Yes, perhaps we can choose to accept God's love or not. Perhaps we can run away from it, but we cannot influence it, manipulate it, or control it by anything that we do, good or bad. So in the face of God's love, we are powerless. And only when we die to all of our delusions of actually being in control do we realize that such loss of perceived freedom and power is actually life-giving. God's love, you see, is tenacious. Or to use a churchy word, God's love is steadfast. And so God's love will continue to chase after us, seeking to hold on to us and to redeem us in all. all of the days of our lives, whether we like it or not. Which brings me back to Patrick, my confidant. My prayer today is that Patrick remembers these two verses and that they bring him comfort and peace. You see, Patrick's best friend Greg, another boy in that same confirmation class so long ago, died in a brutal manner 20 years ago while Patrick was with him. I don't know all the details, and I would never pry into his family's deep pain to ask, but I have my suspicions. I loved Greg too. He was a wonderful kid from a wonderful family, and so was Patrick. The years since Greg's death have been hard on his parents and his sister, but perhaps hardest on Patrick, if that's possible. Like many other 30-plus somethings, Patrick has left the church. And today, still feeling the guilt and sorrow of Greg's death, Patrick is but a shadow of his former self. Perhaps he doesn't remember that God loves him so much that God will never let him go. So maybe this popular verse, if we took it more seriously, might terrify us in how it renders us powerless in a world literally hell-bent on accumulating and exercising power. Then again, maybe as we remember God's tenacious love, we realize that precisely because this is the one relationship in our lives over which we have no power, it is also the one relationship we can never screw up. Because God created it, God maintains it, and God will bring it to a good end. All through the power of God's vulnerability, self-sacrificing, and ever so tenacious love. Whether we like it or not. Amen.
Thank you.
And now let us together recite the words of our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into death. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all who are in need. You sent your Son that the world might be saved through him. Inspire the witness of the church throughout the world. Empower missionaries, Bible translators, and ministries of the church and service in your name. Bless our partners in ministry, Lutheran World Hunger Appeal and Lutheran Disaster Relief, our ELCA Global Partner Churches, and young adults in Global Mission. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
From east to west, your steadfast love is shown. Nourish seas and deserts, wilderness areas and cities. Give water to thirsty lands. Nurture spring growth that feeds hungry creatures. Bless farmers as they prepare for the growing season. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You sustained your people in the wilderness. Give courage to all who lead in times of crisis and scarce resources. Prosper the work of those who aid victims of famine, drought, and this pandemic. We pray for a number of people who have been diagnosed with COVID-19 this week. We pray for Becky's sister Rhea's family, her son Jamie and his wife Joanna, and their children Cole and Katie. We pray for Linda Strine's grandson Jacob and the rest of that family who is now living upstairs with Linda, and they have been tested and are awaiting results. We pray for Heidi Cummings' friend, Penny Holbrook. Again, all who have been diagnosed with COVID-19. And we rejoice that Mo and Dave's tests came back negative. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Your mercy endures forever. Deliver all who cry to you, especially those who are hungry or without homes. Give life in places where death seems triumphant. Give healing to those who are sick and comfort to those who mourn. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
By grace, we have been saved. Fill this congregation that exists today in virtual space. Make it overflowing with that grace, that we show mercy to others. Nourish any in our midst who are hungry, especially children, and bless our ministries of feeding and shelter, especially the Saturday community meal. Give us patience and courage when the way seems long. Hear us, O Lord.
Your mercy is great.
For whom or for what else do the people of God pray? For Carol, for Cindy, for Jeff. If you'd like to unmute yourself to share your prayer with others, you can do that now.
Are going to know him for sure, seniors.
deliver us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
For whom else do we uplift or pray for? O God, we know you hear our silent prayers. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Your Son was lifted up that whoever believes might have eternal life. We praise you for all you have done in Christ. We praise all who have died in Christ. Bring us with all the saints into the fullness of your promises. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
And if you'd like to unmute yourself and greet each other, let's do that.
You.
Greetings, peace.
Peace
to all of you.
Hey, Dad. Amen, sister.
Her wave is good, too. Elbow, virtual elbow bump. Okay. Oh, that was Jeanette. Peace to all of you. Let us again pray. Faithful God, you walk beside us in desert places, and you meet us in our hunger with bread from heaven. Accompany us in this coming meal, that we may pass over from death to life with Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed with the joy and the gift of our baptisms, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and to teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are welcome at the table of love and forgiveness. And again, I would suggest that you say, this is the body of Christ given for you, and the other person receive it with a thank you, with an amen. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. And again, the response is amen. If you're by yourself, say those words to yourself out loud, and then say amen. Doris, this is the body of Christ broken for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen.
Pastor, the body of Christ broken for you and the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. Body and blood of our gracious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of steadfast love, at this table you gathered your people into one body for the sake of the world. Send us in the power of your Spirit that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Hear now the blessing. May your peace be greater than your worries, and may your compassion be bigger than your fear. May you do something good, and may you find joy in unexpected places. May you remember that fun is an important part of life. May your coffee cup or tea stay full. May your heart be calm, and may your hope be strong.
Amen.
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 that God loves you.
We will. Thanks be to God.
Stay for Becky's postlude. Thank you, Becky. How many of you could not help but be moving while Becky was playing? Tapping your toes